weakling in speech. I'm a very large person, so it's a testimony in itself of me to even standing here looking at this. But God gives me strength. I just want to read a bit of scripture before I give you my testimony. So 1 Corinthians 1:27. Instead, God has chosen what is foolish in the world to shame the wise, and God has chosen what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God has chosen what is insignificant and despised in the world, what is used as nothing to bring nothing, what is used as something, so that no one can boast in his presence. But it is from him that you are in Christ Jesus, who became God-given wisdom for us, our righteousness, sanctification, and redemption, in order that, as it is written, the one who boasts must boast in the Lord. Amen. I grew up in Scotland with a Catholic family. My mother was very religious. We had just come back from Canada. I was an altar boy in Canada when I was 8 years of age. And we were in a town in Scotland called Irvine. And I woke up one morning, I was 10-year-old, and I had a severe pain in my stomach, and I had burst appendix. Ambulance came and took me to the hospital, and I was in there for a couple of days. My father came in. My name is Marshall Connor, my dad's name is Marshall Connor as well. He came in and he said, "Son, I've got to leave. I've got to go to Australia. The Gavs are after me." So he jumped on the plane and he had to leave me in the hospital. I've got a brother and a little sister. And my mother came to pick me up from the hospital, and we were stopping in Irvine behind a garage. The old ladies never still remember her name, was Mrs. Semple. And when my mum came to pick me up and took me back to the garage where the trailer wasn't there. Somebody had chored it. That trailer was to pay for our airfare to Australia. And the plan was to go to Australia for about 6 to 8 weeks, just to let things calm down a bit. And my dad had to earn the money to send for us then, because the trailer was gone. The 6 weeks turned into 43 years because my mother died there. And that's when my religion died. I hated God for taking away my mother. I was only 10 years of age, so I wouldn't. My sister was about 8, my brother Chris was 11. I said I hated God, but I knew deep down that God was always with me. I got a bit older, I was about 15-year-old. Me and my little sister was in a car. And I stopped at a stop sign, because there's not many roundabouts in Australia, just before I got on the motorway, and he said, "Put your seatbelt on." And we had a very, very bad car crash. I'm not exaggerating, the car rolled over 3 or 4 times. Not a scratch on us. And when my father came to pick us up, I said, "There's not a lot of damage, Dad, to the car. We'll go back there in the morning and I'll give you a couple of $1,000 to fix it." When we went back there the next morning, the gear stick of the car was touching the roof. The car was a complete wreck. So God was looking after me then. Years went by and I married my wife, Roseanne. Had 4 children. I've got 17 grandchildren now. I was one of the last Connors alive. Now I've got 9 grandchildren, praise God. The hymns has come over to Australia and testified to me. I was up and down the country, Queensland, went to a lot of gorgeous churches because there were no travel churches over there at that time. I'd sit in the car, go into church. Eventually, I was in a church in a place called Gosford near Sydney, and Tony Knowles and Ruby Knowles was in there. I gave my heart to the Lord, and I've never looked back since. I was coming back this year. I'll stop the story for a minute. When I was about 25 years ago, age, I was on a trailer park in Camden with Billy Orchard and Rob Orchard. I was speaking to my only brother Chris in Melbourne. Melbourne's about 800 kilometres away. And I was sending my young son, who was 17-year-old, down to do 3 or 4 roofs to paint. So I rang my brother up because he was feeling a bit down. I said to my brother Chris, I said, "Little Marshall will be down in a couple of days. We've got some jobs to do." And he sounded a bit down. And I said to him, "Don't do nothing stupid, Chris. Marshall will be there in a couple of days. There's plenty of work to do." I got a phone call the next day. My brother had killed himself. He got a deposit for a new house. Took his wife and children there. And then he drove 50 miles back to the old house. Into the garage with the car. He got a Hoover pipe. Put it through the window. He died. Now God got me through that. That was my only brother. God got me through that by giving me a picture of the devil. because the devil is real. The devil whispered in his ear, Chris, you're useless. Nobody loves you. Nobody needs you. Just get in the car, turn the engine on, you'll be all right. My brother never had Jesus in his life. If he had Jesus in his life, Jesus would have said to him, Christopher, you're loved. Your family loves you. You're needed. Don't do it, Chris. And I want to say to everybody here that's had any family members that's either committed suicide or died without knowing Jesus, you don't know that in the dying moments that they didn't give their hearts to Jesus. So don't let it put you off giving your heart, because there's a lot of people that say, I want to go where my family went. You don't know where your family is. I was coming back to the convention this year in July. There was four families of us coming back. Three of them never come back for different reasons. I had a heart attack. My brother-in-law there happened to give his testimony earlier. His little granddaughter, we used to vote prayed for her, London Rose, she had a fit and nearly died. But with the power of prayer, she's getting good now. I was at work and I was getting pains in my chest. It was nothing like you could see on the television, people crouched down and severe. I wasn't taking any notes, but I do believe God was looking after me. It was just like heartburn. I was 100 kilometres away from home, 60 miles away from home, and I was on a roof. God was giving me the sign, Marshall, go to the doctors. And I wouldn't take any notes. I went seeing another job, and I was debating whether to climb up the ladder and clean it before I went home. And my eye went blurry, and I decided to go to the doctors. When I went to the doctors, the cardiac machine wouldn't work, so the little Pakistani man said to me, you'll be all right, just go home. But there was a nurse there, a New Zealand nurse, and she said, go to the hospital. And the last person said, you'll be all right, and a massive heart attack. Anyway, I got to the doctors, the hospital, with my wife and my brother-in-law, and the doctor came in and he said, yeah, you're having a heart attack, and when it comes to reality, when you realise that you're facing possible death, and I looked at the children and I prayed to God and said, please God, don't let me go. Anyway, they put me into the place and I was thinking I was going to get one little stint and jump on the plane and come back to the convention, but it wasn't me. They looked at me and I had very, very severe blockages. I had six stints put in. And the doctor said to me, he said, Marshall, he said, do you realise if you'd got on the plane, your heart would have exploded and you wouldn't have been going nowhere. So I praise God for that. God's got a plan and purpose for every single person in this place. And I believe that I'm here for a reason. And I'm going to go to every church I can while I'm here and testify of the power of Jesus, because I'm here. So God bless. Thank you very much.